Hey everyone, welcome to my next video. In this one, I want to continue on the independent build process, in this case using Visual Studio Code. So the one thing that is missing is debugging. So I want to show you two ways how you can compile and debug with STLink or with Sager's JLink. So for the hardware, I have my discovery board running the JLink on the embedded debugger. And on the other board, I have running the stock STLink. Both debuggers have the latest versions on them. Here I have my virtual machine for Windows, because some of the software is Windows only. For updating the STLink versions, you can use this STLink upgrade utility. You can go on the ST's website or just search for STLink upgrade, and you can download the software. You connect your microcontroller, connect, and then upgrade the firmware. For the JLink and how I went to have the embedded STLink as a JLink is by using their official reflash utility. It converts the STLink on board to a JLink. And this is the executable. It has a few options. The first one is to upgrade to JLink, which is the one that you're gonna use, and then you can update the JLink firmware. Don't worry, this is not a one-way street and it's not a permanent upgrade. In this case, you can restore back the STLink version, but this probably won't be the latest one, so you can then use this software to update the version again. So this is for the hardware version, next for the software. In order to debug, you need an intermediate program that connects and talks to the debugger. For the STLink version, I'm gonna be using the same software as in the previous video, which is the open source STLink tool. We use the so-called STFlash utility, which was used for downloading and writing to the flash memory. But today we're gonna be using the st-util one, which is provided in the same package. And this is the one they use for the GDB debugging. As you can see, it says clearly that it's supported in Visual Studio Code using the Cortex-Debug plugin. This is just for us. For the JLink side, you can go again with the same JLink software and documentation pack that you had to download in order to have the JLink .exe executable, which is used for downloading code onto your microcontroller. In the same package also includes the GDB version. If I show you on my system where I have it in opt JLink, and this is the folder that has all the executables provided to us by JLink. And the one that we used before for downloading a code was JLink .exe, but today we're gonna be using the JLink GDB server. I have them exported in my path, so if I go JLink GDB server, you can see this is the server that is running and it's connected. We're gonna stop it, and JLink GDB, you can see that it's located in user local bin. So this is the link that I have created for it. My st-util is available in my Nix package manager, and I'm going to show it to you later. So now let's go to the Visual Studio Code and what you need to have installed here. So the first thing you might saw before is the extension called the Cortex-Debug. It's over here already installed, and you can see a preview of what you're going to be using. So the current line is going to be highlighted. You can put breakpoints with red dots. We're going to be able to see local variables, global and static variables. You can put in watch variables, so you can view some specific variables. If they're local, they're going to be available only in their own scope, but if they're global, they're going to be available all the time. Then we have also the call stack, which is handy to see how the function was called in which order, and then also the Cortex registers. Meanwhile, Cortex Peripherals is a function that I don't have enabled because I don't really need it, but it can also serve so you can view the Cortex registers all the time. Now that you have installed the plugin, let's configure it to work with your project. For that, you go into the file structure and you want to create firstly the file called settings.json. You might have it if you have other configurations already present, but in this file, I just added a few paths. In this case, I'm working with JLink and STLink, so I put in both, and then also the GDB path. In this case, in my case, my rnonAbi GDB is located in some weird path over here, which I'm using for temporarily, and my st-util is also in this weird path, but my JLink GDB server is where I showed you before. It's in user local bin GDB. This can be any folder on your system, so as long as the Cortex debug knows where to find the executable. The next one is the configuration. You have to create this file called launch.json, and again create some kind of configurations. Don't worry, I'm gonna provide all these files in the GitHub, so you can just copy it and modify it for your own project. But it's really basic. Some mandatory stuff like project name and version, the configurations, and then you just put in different curly brackets and a comma separated, so you can separate different configurations for either different microcontrollers, different debuggers, or different sessions. In this case, I have two. The first one is debug, which is the name of this configuration. The current working directory is root, and the executable, which is located in /build/the name of the project.elf. You have to use the elf instead of bin, because this one includes all the debug information. Then is the request type, which can be either launch or attach. You can see that this is the only one that is different between these two configurations. So this one is attach, and this one is launch. The difference is the launch will do something that you're used to, so it's gonna re-download the binary onto the microcontroller and restart the debugging session from the beginning. Meanwhile, attach will silently attach to the debugger and will not disturb the processor unless there's a breakpoint or you manually stop the processor. So this one is when you want to silently just attach to it. One warning, if you're going to attach to your microcontroller, make sure that the version running on the microcontroller is the same as you have currently loaded. If not, you have to download the new code, so might as well use the launch version. The type is Cortex-Debug, which is gonna also enable all the future highlighting and, in this case, suggestions. So for the server type, if I click Control Space, these are all the different servers that the Cortex-Debug plugin supports. And for the JLink one, I need the JLink. The device in this case has to be exact name, so I just put it in capital letters. So it has to be the first three numbers of your version, so in this case it's an F407, and the first two letters, which are used to distinguish the particular version of the microcontroller. No more letters needed. The interface in this case on all these platforms of Nucleo and Discovery are SWD, but you have a JTAG, then you have to specify JTAG. I also have enabled run to main as true, so when I start the debug session, it's gonna start at main and not in the reset handler. I've also configured a pre-launch task, which is very handy. In the previous video, we made a few tasks in task.json, like build all, which is gonna run make all. So before the actual debug session starts, this is gonna launch the make in order to build the entire project before downloading the new code. So this is so you can have always the latest version without manually recompiling, so the debug session is gonna compile it for you. The next one is optional. The SVD file is the one that is used to actually view the Cortex registers and peripherals. If you do not care for that, I don't really bother with it, but if you want to view also all the peripheral states, you have to find the package that contains all the SVD files. The last one is the SWO, so if you're using the trace output, the single wire output, you have to configure it, like enable it, set the exact system frequency, the SWO frequency is usually 4 MHz, and then enable in this case port 0, which is the default one, and to print it out to the console and encode the ASCII. We're just sending characters, so this is ASCII. As I said before, these two are identical, except this one is using the attach instead of launch. So this is all. Let's go to the ST, let's save this one, and let's go to the ST's one so you can see what's the difference. So this is the ST one. As you can see, the settings are exactly the same. I just included one more redundant path. But other than that, the whole configuration is the same. I've just copied and pasted. As you can see, I haven't even changed the name of this project, but the executable, in this case, the ELF binary, is the correct one. Everything is the same, except over here I've specified the st-util, so it's gonna launch the st-util. Then, of course, because I have a different processor on this board, I've included a different device number. Also, over here, you can see the pre-launch commands, in this case not tasks, because I don't have any tasks configured in this project, I'm just using the pre-launch command, so I'm just manually triggering the make with 8 cores. So this is again, do the same thing, it's gonna launch make, so before the debugging start, I have the newest version. Then we can go into run and debug over here and click run. All your sessions are gonna be displayed over here, so if you have, in this case, two of them, let's go to run a debug, you can see that both of them are available. So let's start with JLink, why not? Let's run it. So as you can see, it recompiled everything. It went really fast and it's already deleted. So it already deleted it, but it started it. Probably is somewhere over here. Yes, over here. So it started the build.all task. And you can see it recompiled before starting. It also enabled the output terminal for the SWO, the one we have configured, so the trace is enabled. You can see this is the menu toolbar that you can use to position anywhere you want, and it started at the beginning of the main. You can use F10 to jump over the lines and execute them, and use F11 to go into them, and then Shift F11 to go back out of them. Here we can see on the left the variable view, so for the local, global and static. Statics I think are empty, that's right. And in the global houses stuff like some UART handlers, RTC handlers, system core clock, some global variables. But the local variables are the ones that are currently in scope. In this case var1, var2, var3 and var4. And if I click F10, this is gonna execute one by one. If I put in a breakpoint, I can click F5. And this is gonna run to this point. As you can see, something has been already printing in the trace output. That's because this is printing in an interrupt. If I put in a breakpoint inside the interrupt and let's delete this one, or you can do it over here on the left on the bottom, so you can find the breakpoint and just disable it for the time being. Click F5 and we have run into the interrupt. So you can see that we can see the call stack over here, which is very handy. So we were running in main, especially in this line. Then the signal handler happened and went firstly into the RTC wake up IRQ handler. So this is the function that it's called by the interrupt. Then we went into this one. So this is the next one. And then over here, we called this one. And the specific implementation is listed in the beginning of the main. Then this one called F1, F1 called F2 and F2 called F3. And now we are here. So we can go forward. We can jump over print string, and as you can see, we've printed another string. This one is gonna print over UART, and this one is gonna toggle the LED, and F5 again, so after 1 second, we're back over here. So now let's launch the STLink, run, and as you can see, it all worked good. It just didn't start over here, but over here, but this is exactly the same. But we got a warning, so SWO is not supported, and that's right, currently in st-util, SWO is not supported, so it's automatically not using the SWO. So this is a downside at the current time. We can again use the same exact function, so we can use F10, but as you can see, it's working a little bit slower right now, so we can still put all the different breakpoints everywhere, but it's working a little bit slower. So what I want to point out before is that something weird is going on. Some variables are not available at the local view, and it's not just this session or in this configuration, it's in the ST and the JLink as well. So let's go to this one because I like it because it's working faster and see why is that so. That's because some optimizations are being used by default. So let's go over here to the make file that was provided to us by CubeMX. And by default, this optimization is OG. So a little bit of optimizations for debugging purposes. So one of those things that it doesn't optimize is the call stack. So it doesn't optimize an inline function, so it executes faster. But it does, as you saw, optimize away some variables that the compiler thinks that are not being used. So we can force it to do not optimize anything by giving it an option of O0. This is disabling all optimizations, so when you're debugging, you can view your code and debug it as you wrote it without any distracting optimizations, and then you enable them when you're doing a release version. Similarly, on the bottom over here, there's a flag for the compiler for the debugging. -G enables the debug symbols, but if you put in G3, it's gonna enable more of them and they're gonna be more verbose, so your debugging is gonna be better. So I suggest you enable G3 and disable all optimization with O0 for all debugging purposes. Now you need to recompile it. So let's call manually make -8. So it's gonna recompile the entire board. And then let's start again the session. So let's go to run debug, JLink debug. As you can see, it's very fast. Let's go back to here. So let's enable this breakpoint, run to it. And as you can see now that all the variables are available, so all of them are being shown, none have been optimized away, and we can just jump over it. Let's disable this one and go back into this routine over here. And as you can see, the whole stack trace is available. For just a quick test, let's change that back to the highest optimization level, or O3. Let's recompile everything. Stop the session and start it again. So now some optimizations are already enabled, so in this case all of them. So if we run F5, you can see something really weird. So firstly, we were in main, and specifically we were calculating this random number when the signal handler was called. But what's different than when the signal handler was called, it didn't call the parent function. In this case, let's go to find the parent function, which is IT over here. So it didn't call directly the RTC wake up IRQ handler, as we would have thought, but it directly went into the function in here. So this is this one. And then, even then, it didn't call this one, but it went directly into F3. So what it did, it inlined this function over here, and then over here, and then over here, and directly over here back into the parent function. Because it thought all these variables over here are dummy, there's nothing useful being done with them, so it optimized those away, and when those went optimized away, it inlined the function so it doesn't have such a long call stack. So in this case, we're going from the signal handler, one, two jumps directly into our meat of our code. So this is something that you have to be aware of when you're debugging, because your compiler will optimize a lot of things away. So these variables might not be available. So this is all. So I have shown you two different versions. So one is a JLink and one is an STLink. Again, all these tools are Windows, Mac, and Linux available, so you should have no problem. It's all universal. Do be aware of this debugging, so make sure you turn the G3 and the O0, so no optimization and the highest level debugging is available to you. In my case, as you saw, the JLink is working very fast and the STLink is working a bit slow. But I'm gonna be looking into the st-util, how it's gonna advance over the time, because I would rather use a non-proprietary tool if it's better than the proprietary one. So thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!